Okay, so welcome back, and this is one of the most interesting topics for me, and the beauty about signal processing or image processing and Fourier transform, for example, is really illustrated in this particular chart. Okay, so let's actually consider an image, okay, some image which is looking like this. It's sort of concentric circles which is going, and you can see some sort of ripples actually happening here, okay, and the Fourier transform of this image looks like this. Okay, so now you should be very comfortable with Fourier transform and all those aspects. Okay, so this is interesting. And now what I'm going to do is I take this image. Okay, so I'm going to kill this image in such a way that I will take every fourth sample in both horizontal and vertical direction. So what essentially I'm doing is, let's say your original image is IM. Okay, so this is my original image. So the new image, basically IM1, let's call, is nothing but 1:4:N. Okay, so this will make it very clear to you. End, and then it looks like this. Okay, so that's interesting. Okay, now I just killed the image. it's completely gone, and this property is something known as aliasing. Okay, so this is really understood with the help of a Fourier transform, and if you're coming from signal processing background, you're already aware of this property in 1D signals, and you just need to extend that to 2D signals. That's all. So this is a very, very important thing, and you need to be careful, and this is where the Fourier transform and the low pass filter, for example, you studied, will help you a lot. So when if you really want to downsample the image, you should not actually do direct operation, just like what I did over here. It's really banned, and it's really going to kill your image. Okay, so what you essentially do, so basically you distort the image. That's a big problem. Okay, so what you need to basically do is, this is the correct process. So first you need to actually low pass filter. You make the image smooth. So definitely I agree with you that by doing low pass filtering, you may chuck off some of the information, right? You are really killing some of the sudden transitions in the image. But there is no way out if you want to downsample the image. This is the only way out. So you do smoothing of the image, all the sudden transitions in the image is removed, and then you do downsampling. Then you keep the things mostly intact. Okay, so we'll see the correct version of the downsampled version of this image in the next slide. But before that, I want to have a very quick, sharp introduction to aliasing, okay, and sampling. Okay, and some people call it a sampling theorem. Okay, so if you are really not worried about these jargons, just ignore it. It's a very, very interesting operation. Okay, let's actually explain this with the help of a 1D signal, which is easily extendable to 2D. So this is just a quick short introduction. I'm really not going into the complete details here, because it's not really part of this course, right? But I want to, because many people are from computer science background and they are not really aware of this process. So I just wanted to tell you, okay? So an analog signal is nothing but you have actually continuous in time and continuous in amplitude. So you can treat this as the original image, for example. Okay, so then you are going to downsample it. Essentially, it means that every maybe some samples are kept, others are sort of removed. That's what downsampling is, right? You are throwing away some pixels from the image, for example. So you really, first step is really to make them zero and then discard them. So that's what really going to do. Okay, so the operation is something like, it can be approximated as, you have an 1D signal, you're multiplying by a series of delta functions of Dirac deltas, and you end up in getting something like this. So essentially this plot and this plot are related. Only difference is like these samples. Okay, so those are gone. So these are actually these regions. So those regions basically will come somewhere in between, and those are really gone. So you only have certain samples kept. The remaining samples from the original signal, or in this case, in our case, original image is discarded. So x of t is your original signal. G delta of t is the pulse train that you can imagine. And then y of t is sort of the resultant of the multiplication. So this is something which can be expressed in a simple mathematical expression, right? Y of t is nothing but the product of x of t, or x of t multiplied by this Dirac delta series, okay? Now I'm going to take Fourier transform on both sides, okay? So this is periodic, so people say that it can be Fourier series, okay? So let's assume so, but I'm going to take Fourier transform to start with. So, okay, so before that, yeah, I'm correct actually. So this term, this guy is a periodic signal. You can see that it is repeating, right? So it's a periodic signal, and this can be expressed in terms of your Fourier series. So if you're coming without this background, just ignore it. You just accept what I'm saying, okay? So this can be actually easily proven. I mean, you can take the Fourier series. I'm thinking you studied Fourier series already in plus two, so it should be able to appreciate that. So a Dirac delta function, if I represent this in terms of its Fourier series, because it's a periodic function, I can get something like this. So it's an infinite sum of exponentials or infinite sum of sinusoids, right? And you can see this is a frequency which is actually this time interval. So let me call this time interval. Okay, just discard it. Okay, just a moment. Okay, so let's call this time interval, whatever the time interval, as dt. Okay, and then fs is nothing but 1 by dt. Okay, so this fs I'm talking about. So you can express the Dirac delta series in terms of its Fourier coefficients, and this is the formula for it. So this is sort of again same like Fourier representation. This signal can be represented as a sum of sinusoids, okay, and that's what you're actually having here. And fs, as you can see over here, nfs. So fs, n will become minus infinity to plus infinity. So let's say n is 0, then this guy will be 0, everything will be 1. Then you have n equal to 1, that means fs, n equal to 2, that means 2fs, n equal to 3, that means 3fs, and so on. So it's a sum of sinusoids, as simple as that. Now let's take Fourier transform on both sides, okay? So y of t, Fourier transform is y of f, and I'm going to take Fourier transform of these two, so it will be x of t multiplied by 1 by ts of this one, okay? Right? And now the interesting fact, we already know that multiplication becomes, so basically this is multiplication, so it will be convolution, right? So multiplication becomes convolution, convolution becomes multiplication. They are dual, okay? So in this case, if I take Fourier transform, it is nothing but Fourier transform of x of t convolved with Fourier transform of this guy, okay? So it means the Fourier transform of this guy, if I take, it will be going back to the delta, okay? And the delta indices will be F0FS, 2FS, 3FS, etc. So basically, this will become as simple as this. If I put inside, so basic, okay, maybe one step I missed it. So this will be equivalent to x of f, which is a Fourier transform of x of t. This will be convolved with, okay, that will be convolved with something like dou of f minus n fs, okay. So the Fourier transform of this guy will become this guy, okay. Basically this guy, the entire thing will become this guy. And this is nothing but x. Okay, so once you have this, I put it inside and then it becomes this particular expression. Okay, so x of f minus nfs. So if you literally think, if you ignore all these, you really, if you're not interested in any of these, if you see this, I'm going to plot this at this point. Okay, so one of the important aspect is this, which we discussed in the last slide also. So my assumption is like the signal, this particular signal x of t, to start with, is band limited. That means it is a compressed signal. If it is not really compressed, we have to make it compressed, and that is what is known as anti-aliasing filter. And let me explain this, okay? You can ignore this. If you not understand this, just ignore it. Okay, let's say x of f, the Fourier transform of your signal x of t looks like this. So here, this is what I was telling, okay? So this is band limited. It has a certain band. It goes from minus B frequency to plus B frequency. So ideally, if you see any analog signal or any signal in analog world, it may not be band limited. It can extend from minus infinity to plus infinity. The frequency can extend. What I'm saying is, the frequency can be something like this, from minus infinity to plus infinity. If that is the case, we need to ensure that we pre-filter this and make it band limited, like the blue signal that we are seeing over here. Okay, that is very important. The reason why, I will explain in the next few steps. So now this is x of f. Now y of f is explained as this, right? F, and you are shifting it in terms of nfs and onwards, right? So basically, you see over here, so this is 0, okay? And this is fs, this is minus fs, and you will have 2fs, 3fs, 4fs, and so on. So it just keeps on repeating, okay? So basically, what you are really doing is, this guy is convolved with something like this, okay? So you have a delta function here at 0. Then you have another delta function which is actually fs. You have another delta function which is at 2fs, and so on. Here also minus fs, minus 2fs, right? Everywhere you will have delta functions. So you are going to convolve this guy with this guy. Then what happens is, this guy is going to sit on all of them, right? You have the fs here, minus fs here, 2fs here, and so on, all of them, right? So now, if you see this distance, okay, so this distance is an important factor. If I go for a lower efforts, this guy will come closer. Then what will happen is, okay, so this guy has certain bandwidth. If this guy comes closer, then it's going to start interact with this, right? So the next efforts is going to come closer. These guys will come closer, and then these portions will get aliased. So I have a nice explanation in the next slide. So that is essentially the problem we are facing, okay? So if this is not really band limited, then sampling will create issue all the time. If it is band limited also, you have to ensure this criteria. So the sampling frequency or the rate at which you're going to sample should be actually at least 2 times B, basically this width, okay? If it is not, then it is going to interact, and these guys will get interacting with each other, and you will get a lot of aliasing effect. So that is very important, and this is what we saw in the previous slide, where the entire image got disrupted because I didn't ensure this band limiting, okay? So now I have an explanation. If you didn't understand this slide, just ignore, okay? And this, by the way, those who are coming from signal processing already knows what is this theorem all about. So this is nothing but Nyquist-Shannon sampling theorem. So those who are from computer science, if you appreciate this slide, if you want to really dig deep in this slide, and if you want to discuss with me if you didn't understand this, please always come back to me. And this is the well-popular, the ever-popular Nyquist criteria or the Nyquist-Shannon sampling theorem, okay? So let's illustrate this using this particular case, okay? So I have a band-limited signal. So basically one more thing. So this FS, always remember that you have, I think this is important. This FS is nothing but 1 by dt, this time interval, right? So if I'm going to increase the FS, you are going to decrease this dt. Always remember that means this is going to come closer, okay? So this guy is going to come closer. So if I increase the FS like very high, that essentially means I am going to pick all the samples which are closer to each other. That means you're really going to do very fine sampling. So if I increase dt, that means the spacing is increased. This spacing is increased. That means I'm going to miss many samples. And obviously, your sampling rate will come down. And that is where aliasing is bound to happen. So you can illustrate or you can think of in that perspective also. So if you have a very finer sampling, then that means basically you are really, really doing justice in the sense like your sampling rate is very high, your sampling frequency is very high, right? And then that means that you are really not missing any samples. There's no issue. But the moment you increase reduce the sampling frequency, that means you are really going to make the things wider and wider, and that means really, really you're going to miss many things. Okay? So this is an illustration. So I have a band limited signal, so minus F to plus F, similar to minus B to plus B in the previous slide. And this is where actually my sampling rate is, okay? Now what essentially happens in this case, FS is exactly 2 times, okay? Exactly 2 times this width. So that means this is my 0, the next FS will come here, and this is exactly 2B. That's the meaning of it, right? This guy is exactly 2F in this case, because this is basically F, and this is also F. So F plus F is 2F. So exactly fit, no issues here, okay? Now let's actually remove that. Okay, let me just remove the ink. Let's consider this case where FS is less than 2F, okay? So then that means basically you always remember this is F, okay? And this is also F. So here what essentially happened is this distance, which is FS, is actually less than 2F, right? That's what essentially happened. And then you see this portion is gone. That is known as aliasing. And that's exactly happened in the previous case. And if FS is very much greater than 2F, there's no issue. You have a lot of breathing space. So here, this distance is FS, and that is very much, very much greater than 2 times F, because this is F, and this is F, right? So this is F and F, and you have so much of boundary region here, which is actually much greater than 2F, okay? So this is way oversampling, okay? Or it is like a sort of highly oversampled case. Now, as I said, if you want to prevent aliasing, what you need to do is you fix a sampling frequency, okay? You fix a sampling frequency. So this is the other way. Let's say you have an FS fixed already, and then you should know that it should be at least greater than or equal to 2F dash, okay? So let's call this new frequency as F dash. Then you have to be, you put this 2 here, so this F dash, okay, should be less than or equal to FS, right, by 2. So this has to be ensured all the time. So basically, if you are going to downsample by 2, your image is going to be downsampled by 2, what you need to do is you need to pre-filter the image with a new cutoff. Okay? So you can imagine this FS is equivalent to something like 2 pi. Okay, so you remember our space, our Fourier transform space was 0 to 2 pi, right, or minus pi to pi. So this pi, fs is equal to 2 pi. I just wanted to put that way. So let's not confuse here. Fs is equal to 2 pi, right, and fs by 2 is equal to pi. Okay, so this is important. So you really have to change the fs by 2, right? I mean, you have to redefine your fs by 2. So if you're going to downsample by 2, that means you're really going to change your fs again by 2, and then you have to actually have a cutoff which is at pi by 2, for example, and then you do downsampling, there is no issue. So that is the beauty about this, the low pass filtering before the downsampling operation. So let's do that. Okay, so in this case, what I'm going to show is this original image again, the Fourier transform again. So I'm going to do a pre-filtering. So what essentially I'm going to do is I will have a, so you can actually pre-filter this image. So essentially what is going to happen is you will put a circle something like this, okay, and the remaining part I will chuck off. Okay, so I'll just pre-filter this image using something like this. So I design a circle filter. This region will be pass band. Okay, so this entire region will be pass band, and this region outside will be the stop band. So I'll just have a filter like this, and then I do downsampling on the image. I'll end up in this, and you can see that it is way better than this particular image, right? Sorry. So this image is completely distorted image. And the same operation I did, I didn't do anything, any change, no change. Only thing is actually, I just sort of downsampled it directly, and you ended up in getting a better image. And here everything is preserved. But one information, one important information, please listen. By doing a low pass filter, by doing a pre-filtering, I am really chucking off lot of frequencies, lot of high frequencies, lot of sudden transitions are gone, and that is why you are never be able to reconcile. If you see these two, all these regions are almost gone, right? All these circles which are high frequencies are almost gone in this case, and you end up in preserving sort of the low frequency regions, so the slow moving regions are preserved. And that is understandable because you are doing a distortion operation. Any filtering is a distortion operation, right? Any filtering is like a lossy operation. You are really removing some frequencies, and that is really reflecting. But what I preserved is the original image structure is preserved. So some people call is that aliasing is bad. Filtering is bad. But filtering is better than aliasing, okay? Or maybe some people say filtering is way better than aliasing, okay? So I think that is very important to really notice. Okay, so I would like to conclude this lecture series on Fourier transform and its related applications and these aliasing, interesting aspects to aliasing and all, with a very, very interesting paper. And this is one of the best papers I read actually. And the link to the paper is actually right down here. So this is something they call it as hybrid images. So this is the aliasing which is visually happening inside our mind. Okay, so you have an image which looks like a sad lady. Okay, and if you downsample it without even doing any pre-filtering, that means you're really going to alias the image. If you do that, you get, so this is basically something like downsampled by 2, you end up in getting this. Okay, again I'm going to do another downsampling, you get something like that. And if you see over here, this is a sad face, this looks like a smiling face, and there is an aliasing happening in the human mind. I will tell you the reason for it. Let me actually replicate this for you in MATLAB, and then I will show you why this is happening. Please read this paper, it's a very interesting paper, and I can show you this paper here. Okay, so you can see over here, so we present hybrid images, a technique that produces static images with two interpretations, which change as a function of viewing distance. Okay, so that is very important, and it's a really interesting paper. Please read through it if you are interested. Okay, so let me just go to the MATLAB window and recreate this for you. Okay, so let's actually, I read this image actually, so let me just quickly show you the, how does the original image looks like. Okay. So, yeah, the lady is really sad, okay. Now I'm going to display to you the downsampled image. So I'm going to downsample really 4:1 in both X and Y. And of course, this is a color image, so I'm not going to touch the color channel. And let's actually see how does it look like. So you see, oh, the lady is smiling. But is it really so? You are viewing from a distance, imagine, okay. Now I'm going to make it full screen and you will see the magic. Ah, So what do you see? What you saw just now? There is no change in face, but unfortunately, this looks smiling. This looks not really. This looks smiling. This looks not really. This is amazing because human brain is aliasing for you in this case. Okay. So with that, I will like to stop this lecture, and probably hope all of you enjoyed the entire lecture on domain transformation. We just started off with domain transformation, and we started off with Fourier transform. I just glimpsed through or just hurried through some of the properties of Fourier transform, the power of Fourier transform. You can do filtering in Fourier transform. You can design filters in Fourier transform. And one of the most important aspects is, of course, the aliasing. Okay, so this is like a very important tool in the toolkit for a image processing or a signal processing person. Moment you get an image or a signal, you take the Fourier transform and see whether that is really nice. Okay. And then you can decide on several processing aspects based on what you observe from your Fourier transform. Okay. On that note, I would like to end this lecture, and thanks for joining.